Everyone, so today we will do several problems that involve recursion. Recursion is basically a methodology to solve problems that are defined recursively. They basically are defined from smaller instances of themselves. So we will go over several problems. First, we will solve them using iteration, and then we will solve them using recursion. So let's start with problem number one from lab number 10. Write a method to compute the factorial of an integer n using iteration. So for that, we can create a new class. Let's call it factorial. Let's increase the size so everybody can see what we are doing. So first, let's look at the formula. Basically, we have to compute n factorial, which is the product of all the integers from 1 to the positive number n. So if we would write it as a product, it would be the product from 1 up to n, including n. So if we are given an integer, we have to compute the integer that is this product of the integers up to n. So first we have to define the method signature. So this is a static method, takes all the parameters to the method and returns a value, is a function. And it returns the product of integers, so the return type should be an integer. And let's call it factorial. And the input should be a positive integer n, which is also an integer. So now in order to compute the factorial, we can define the product initially equal with 1, and then either in a while loop or in a for loop is probably easier, we can start iterating from the numbers from 1 up to and including n, and the step after each iteration is to increment I, and we should multiply the previous product with the new integer I. Finally, we should return the product to the main method. So for instance, in the main method, we can actually compute the factorial. Of 3. That should give us 6, is basically 1 multiply with 2 multiply with 3. And if we run it, it basically prints 6. You can compute it for bigger numbers, like for instance the factorial of 10 is 3,628,800, and so on. You can basically compute the factorial of positive numbers. Now, if we want to write the same formula but with a recursion, first let's reason about it. What exactly does it mean? So if we look at this formula for the factorial and we look at the formula for factorial of n minus 1, we will notice that the factorial of n minus 1 is in fact the product of all the integers up to n minus 1. So we can now rewrite the factorial of n as the factorial of n minus 1 multiplied with the last value n. So we can actually see that the product is the same up to the factorial of n minus 1, and then we can add factorial of n, we can add n, we can multiply it with n, and we get the factorial of n. So now we can actually write this recursive case. So the same signature would apply in this case, public static integer, let's call it recursive factorial, and it also takes an integer n as a parameter. Now When we write recursive problems, we should always terminate. So we can see that this number will decrease up to when it gets to 1 or to 0. The moment that it gets to 0, we should actually stop decreasing the number, because factorial of 0 is directly 1. We don't rely on factorial of n minus 1. It's not defined. So in fact, if you would write recursively the factorial function, it basically would be an if statement: if n is 0, then we return 1, else we would basically return n minus 1. So now we can write this recursive case. So if we reach the value of n is equal to 0, we return 1, else we return directly, we can just return n multiplied with recursive factorial of n minus 1. This should only work for values that are positive. We should never call recursive factorial for negative values. We can do that check in the main method, and we don't have to do it at every step through a recursion. So I recommend that we don't call this function with a negative value. So similarly to the previous factorial, we can ask what is the recursive factorial of 10. And in this case, it would return the same value again. So we can see that it works. It basically computes with the recursive method, the same thing that the method that used iteration with the for loop actually computed. Okay, so that solves, in fact, more than what the first problem asks for. The first problem only asks to implement this problem with iteration. Let's go to the next question. So write using loops, again, we start with iteration, to a method that finds the number of occurrences of a specific character in an array of characters. The method signature should be public static int count into an array of characters, the character ch. Okay, so first thing that we are going to do, we are going to create a new class. Let's call it count characters. And we'll start with the signature of the method. So we'll implement it a little bit later. So this method takes an array of characters as the input and the single character, and it counts how many times the characters in that array are the character that is passed as a parameter. So for instance, I would invoke this method with a print statement. Let's just do it that way. Or, yeah, why not? System.out.println. And here we call the method count with a new character array that contains the characters A. Let's say that it contains B, C, A again, maybe another B, maybe another B. And we are asking, how many A's do I have in that array of characters? Okay, so if we would write it with a loop, we would write it, first we would define an integer count to count how many characters are there, initialize it with 0, and for every index I in the array, starting from position 0, as long as I is less than characters.length, which is basically the number of characters in the array, I is incremented at every step. If the character at index I is the same, and this is a primitive type, so we use double equal with the character ch, then we increment the counter with 1. After we finish the for loop, we have in the count variable the number of how many times the character ch occurs in cars. So we return ch. So in our case, because we had 3 A's in that array, it will actually print 97. we should return the count, not the ch. Sorry about that. So it will return 3. If we have additional a's, for instance another a and maybe another a, it will return 5. So we can see that it actually works properly. So now let's think of a recursive solution for this problem. For this problem, we can actually compare the first character and see if it's the character that we are looking for, and then we can create a new array with one less character and call recursively the method with the rest of the characters in the array. However, this will require to create a lot of arrays of that number of characters. Basically, it will, if we have an array of 10 characters, it will call recursively the method on a new array of 9 characters, then on a new array with 8 characters, and so on. So it's actually easier to use the same character array cars and an index. And we start from the first position, and we call recursively for the next position, and so on, up to when we get to the end of the array. And that is the base case. So we will use a helper method. So let's write the same signature for the method. This is the recursive method. We can call it recursive count with a character array cars and the character ch. And we call another recursive method count. This is the helper method on the same character array cars ch and 0 for the original position of the first character. And now we can write this recursive version. So the helper method takes as an input a character array cars, the character ch, and the position I. If the value of I is actually the length of the characters, that means that we reached at the end of the string and there are no more characters to be returned. So if I is identical with cars dot length, then we can just return 0. Basically, we reach the end of the array. There are no more occurrences of ch after the end of the array. There are no more characters, in fact. Okay. Otherwise, we have to check if the first character or the character at index I is the character ch. So if cars of I is identical with the character ch, then we add 1 to the counter, so we return 1 plus, and now we call recursively recursive count helper on the same characters array ch and I plus 1. Basically, we advance with one position and it basically gets closer and closer to the end of the array. Otherwise, if the character was not the character, the character at index I was not ch, we just return the recursive call. Return recursive count helper. How many are still in cars, the character ch, from index I plus 1? Okay. So this is the recursive version. First we had the iteration version or the iterative version, and this is the recursive version. And the recursive version should return exactly the same output as we had in the case of the iterative version. So we can call recursive count and it should return exactly the same output. And it does. It basically returns 5 exactly as we had in the previous case. Okay, so that solves the second problem. So we have the first problem that computed factorial and the second one that counted the number of occurrences of the specific character in the array. We wrote it using loops and we wrote it using recursion. Next, we want to write a method using loops to return the number of uppercase characters in a string. So this is very similar to this one, except the fact that it doesn't take a character array, it takes a string as the input. So again, we are going to create a new class. Let's call it count uppercase. Okay. So again, we'll start with the method using loops. So let's call it it returns the number of uppercase characters, which is an integer. So let's call it count uppercase. And takes a string as the input. So in this case, the first method is going to use loops. So we can actually iterate in the string and find how many characters are in uppercase. Similar to the previous problem, we start by defining a variable count, initialized with zero. Then we write a loop for every integer I, position I, in the array starting from index zero, as long as I is less than not the array, the string s.length, and this is a method. We have to find how many of these characters are in uppercase. If the character is in uppercase and the character is s.character at position I, then we increment the counter with 1. When we finish counting how many of these letters from index 0 to the length of the array minus 1 are in uppercase, we return the counter. Okay. So now if we want to test this method, let's call the method count uppercase. For any given input string. So let's say how many uppercase are in welcome to Java. Yes. Okay. Let's run it. There are 3 uppercase letters, exactly what we expected. So now let's implement the same method, in this case with recursion. So there are multiple ways to implement it. One way would be to actually check the first character and then call a recursive method with the rest of the string. So we are going to implement it in 2 ways. So let's call this one the recursive version 1. So it will have the same signature as the method above, public static integer recursive count uppercase of a string. And as I said, we are going to do it with recursion in a single method. So if the string is empty, that's the base case, then there are no uppercase letters. In fact, there are no letters or characters whatsoever. So that would be our base case. If s equals with the empty string, then just return 0. Okay. Otherwise, check if the first character, and let's do it with the same method as above. Actually, let's do it differently. The character c is the character at index 0. If the letter, the first that character is greater than equal with A and is less than equal with Z, then we return 1 plus, because it's one of the characters between A and Z, uppercase letters. We return 1 plus the recursive call, for the substring from position 0 from the beginning up to the length of the string minus 1. So basically we remove one character from the string, and actually it should be from position 1 up to the length of the string. We remove the first character of the string. The first character was the one that we looked at. Otherwise, we should just return the value without adding 1 to it. So else the same call but without 1 plus. So this is one version for the recursive version. It is very inefficient because it creates basically n strings, n being the length of the string. It starts with the original string, then one without the first letter, then another one without the first letter, and so on. It is a correct method. It's a little bit inefficient. So we are going to test it again, and let's call the recursive version. For the same string, it will print exactly the same output. There are three characters in uppercase. Let's write another recursive version. So this recursive version will actually use the same string for checking if it's in uppercase. Okay? So, and we are going to use a helper method. So let's call it recursive uppercase 2, the second version. And all that this method does is to call the helper method, like we did in the previous problem. So we are going to call a helper method for this method. Let's call it uppercase 2 helper with the same string starting from position 0. It will be a much simpler implementation because we do not need to copy the strings anymore. So let's define it. And I will just copy the name because it gets longer. So again, it takes a string s as a parameter and an integer I. If again the integer I reaches, and since it's an integer we use double equal the length of the string, we return 0. Otherwise, again, we are going to check if it's in lowercase or uppercase the first letter, so, or the letter at index I. So if character dot is uppercase, the character at index I, then we return 1 plus our method of s and I plus 1. So we basically looked at the character at index I and we returned 1 plus, because it was in uppercase, the recursive call, how many uppercase letters are from the next character from I plus 1. So this will just keep incrementing I without creating additional strings. We'll just pass the original string from the original method count in uppercase to the helper method, and then from the helper method it will just increase the value of I. So what we can see here is that we start from position 0 and then we'll continue up to when we get to the end of the array. So in all of these recursive methods you have a base case, and then you have the rest, which is the recursive relation. Basically, you call recursively how many characters in this case are in uppercase from the next position. Okay. So again, let's test it. For the second recursive version, we should get the same value 3 for how many uppercase letters are in Welcome to Java. And that's exactly what we got. We basically got 3 points for the original method with loops, 3 points for the recursive version 1, and 3 points for the recursive version 2. Okay? Good. So let's continue. Write a program that checks whether a word is a palindrome. A palindrome is a set of values that is the same in reverse. So if you read it from left to right or from right to left, you get exactly the same word. Like for instance, I is a palindrome, ear is not a palindrome, race car is a palindrome, and so on. Because if you read race car from the end to the beginning, it's also race car. And the same with I is the same if you read it left to right or right to left. So we'll write a program that checks whether any word is a palindrome. So let's actually do it first with loops, and then we are going to do it with recursion. In fact, there are many different ways to do it. We can do it in a method that basically looks for shorter and shorter strings. We can actually compute the reverse and check if the reverse is the same with original string, and so on. So let's actually do it with loops first, and then we are going to do it in two ways using recursion again. So we are going to create a new program class. So let's call it palindromes, because basically there will be different implementations of palindromes. So first we'll start with a method that basically does it with loops. So let's check if is palindrome a string and race car is actually a palindrome. So if you read it from left to right, right to left is also race car. Okay? So it should print true, basically, in this case. So the first implementation, we return a boolean, and it takes as an input a string. And let's actually just implement it exactly how it says, how it's defined. It basically says that the string S is the same with its reverse. Okay. That basically means that we actually are going to implement a method reverse. So this method just returns if the string is the same with the string in reverse. So now we are going to implement a method to reverse a string. Returns a string. Takes a string as the parameter. And again, we are going to implement it with loops first. So in this case, we can start with a string. Let's call it result. And initially is empty. And then we are going to iterate with the for loop from the last character of a string to the beginning and add the characters in this string. Okay? So we start with an integer I starting from the last character. So it's the string dot length minus 1. When do we stop? We stop the moment that the string is not anymore greater than or equal with 0. So as long as I is greater than or equal with 0 and I is decremented at every step, the string result is concatenated with the new character at index, the character at index I. And we return the result. So together, these methods will basically also check if the string is a palindrome. So race car is a palindrome, but and so is ear, not ear, I, but ear is not a palindrome. Okay. So we can see that it will print true, true, false. True, true, false. Okay. So this would be a method that uses loops, and it actually uses directly the definition of palindrome. It basically iterates through the string to collect the characters in reverse order and checks if the string is actually a palindrome, if the string is equal with itself in reverse. Now, Let's implement it with recursion. So recursive version 1. Again, we are going to actually call it on smaller and smaller strings. So the signature of the method is the same, only that we change the name into recursive is palindrome. And again, when do we stop? When the string is empty or the string has only one character. So if the length of the string is less than or equal with 1, then it's a palindrome. A string that has one character, you read it left to right or right to left, is the same. An empty string, left to right, right to left, is still the same empty string. Otherwise, we check if the first character, the first character is the same with the last character. So if the character at index 0 is the same with the character at index the length of the string minus 1. So if the first character is the same with the last character, then we can call recursively the recursive is palindrome method with the string without the first and the last characters. So we extract the substring from position 1, we ignore the first character, to position the string.length minus 1, not included. So it basically goes to the end of the string and returns that string. Otherwise, if the first character was not equal with the last character, we return false. That means that it's not a palindrome. So now if we replace our methods in the main method with the recursive version, it will basically print true, true, false, unless we have a problem with the code. Oh, I forgot to finish the method. Sorry about that. Okay, now the problem with this method is that it basically creates substrings of the length of the original string minus 2 at every position, which basically means that we'll have the number of characters in the string divided by two different strings passed around by these recursive methods. So instead of doing it that way, we can actually write a different recursive method. Let's name it recursive method 2. Let's delete this, which actually uses a helper method. Basically, it will use a method with the position that we are looking at. So we can call it recursive palindrome helper method. Which we pass the original string, the position at the beginning of the string, and the position at the end of the string as the low and high indices. Okay. So we have to implement this method. Again, it will return a boolean. And it takes as inputs the string, an integer position low index, and an integer position high index. Now, if the low index becomes greater than equal with the high index, then we are done. Basically, we reach the middle of the string and we can return true. There is no other character that needs to be checked. The string is a palindrome. Otherwise, we check the index, the character at the index of low with the character at index of high, and then we call recursive, if they are equal, we call recursively the method, otherwise we return false. So I'm going to just take this, modify the recursive call. Instead of passing the string, creating a new string, we are going to increment low with 1 and decrement high with 1. And instead of checking the character at index 0, we are going to check if the character at index low is the same with the character at index high. Okay, so this basically should do it. So now, instead of creating shorter and shorter strings as we did it in the recursive version 1, we are going to pass the same string, but we are going to pass the index of the character that is at the beginning and the index of the character at the end. Now, if we reach the middle, that means that we actually either have one character left, which read from left to right, or right to left is the same, we return true. Otherwise, we check if the character at index low is the same with the character at index high. If they are the same, we call recursively the same helper method with the same string with low plus 1 and high minus 1. We basically increment the low index and decrement the high index, and this will actually call recursively the same method. If the character at index low is different than the character at index high, we continue and return false. So our helper method 2 should return the same true, true, false in the case of race, car, eye, and ear. And that's exactly what it returns. So we have now the third version, which is a recursive version of this palindrome. Okay? Now, you can also write another iterative method, which is similar to basically what the is palindrome does, which actually iterates with a for loop without having to create the reverse string. If you want me to do that, please let me know. I can also do that. Okay. Anyone wants me to do that? Okay, good. So let's write another palindrome method. We are going to call it isPalindrome2. And in this version, we are going to actually check if it's palindrome recursively, not recursively with iterations or loops. But instead of creating the reverse string, we are going to check the corresponding characters. So we are going to write a for loop for every integer from the beginning. Let's actually call it low, exactly how we did it in the recursive version. And high is the string length minus 1. We check if low is still less than high, and we decrement low, we increment low and decrement high. And now if the character at index low is different than the character at index high, we are going to return false. If all the characters were the same up to when we reach the middle of the string, we return true. Good. So now we've wrote a different version with loops. Let's actually try it. So in the main method, we are going to try isPalindrome2, the non-recursive version, the second non-recursive version, and should also return true, true, false, because race car is a palindrome, eye is a palindrome, ear is not a palindrome. So now we have actually four versions of palindrome, two that use loops and two that use recursion. Okay, so let's continue with the next problem. Write a factorial method using recursion. We already did that. We actually, in the first method, we did it with loops and then with recursion. So problem number 5 is already solved. Write a recursive method that finds the number of occurrences of a specific character in an array. We actually did that. So we did the iterative version using loops, And now we wrote the recursive method in the same program. So we have the iterative version above and the recursive version with the helper method below. So we solved also problem 6 with exactly the signatures that we actually looked at, except that we called I instead of integer high. Okay, so for problem number 6, just look at the same problem. Next, write a recursive version for the uppercase letters. We also did that. We did it with iteration first, and then we did it with recursion in two different ways. The second way is better. It basically, it's more efficient than the first way because it doesn't create additional strings. It just uses the same string as we did at the beginning. Write a recursive method that computes the sum of the digits in an integer. Let's do this one. So problem number 8, a recursive method that computes the sum of digits in an integer. So let's create a new class. Let's call it sum digits. So if I would have to call this method, I would call it with the method, let's call it sum, and the digits, let's say in 12,345. Okay. So the method, it's a static method, returns an integer, which is the sum of the digits. Let's call it sum, and it takes an integer n. So let's think about how to do it recursively. Basically, if the number has a single digit, and this is a positive number, it should return the number itself, because it returns that digit. So if the number n is less than 10, then just return n. This is the base case. If the number n has more than 10 digits, basically than one digit, or basically is greater than equal with 10, then we should return the last digit, because we can't obtain that using modulo operation. And then we should call recursively sum of the quotient of the division and divide it by 10. And that's it. Basically, it will return 5 plus the sum of the digits in 1234, which will sum 4 with the number of with the sum of 123 and so on. So it will have to return 15, because 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 is 15. So if we run it, it returns 15. And that's basically it. Okay. Write a recursive method that computes the reverse of an integer and returns it. The reverse of an integer contains the digits in reverse order. For instance, the reverse of 12,345 returns 54,321. So let's call it, let's create a new class, reverse integer. And again, I want to write the main method first. So let's pass that value, 12,345. So again, we are going to write the recursive method. Let's just call it reverse, because that's the name that is given in the lab. Okay, so let's see. We basically will need a helper method, because 5 will be actually extracted out with a modulo operation, and we should actually pass it into an accumulator, so that accumulator can be multiplied with 10 in the next step. Okay, so basically what I would like to do have is a recursive method, let's call it also reverse helper, which takes the original integer n and 0. Now we can write the helper method. Takes the integer n and an accumulator. So if the integer n is finished, so if n is basically 0, then we can just return the accumulator. Otherwise, we return the accumulator multiplied with 10. No, we return the reverse helper with the quotient after division with 10 and accumulator multiply with 10 plus the remainder of the division n modulo 10. Okay? So it returns 54,321. So how exactly did it work? Basically, I will actually write here in a comment what did I do. So I started with reverse of 12,345. And that called reverse helper of 12,345 and 0, which returns, because n is different than 0, reverse helper of the quotient of the division of 12,345 with 10, which is 1,234, and the previous accumulator multiplied with 10 plus the remainder of the division, which is just 5. And that method, since the number, the first argument is still not 0, we'll call the same reverse method, reverse helper, of the quotient of the division with 10, which is 123, and the accumulator multiplied with 10, which is 50, 5 multiplied with 10, plus the quotient of 1,234, so it's 54 after division with 10. And this we'll call reverse helper of 12 and 534, which we'll call reverse helper of 1 and 5432, and this we'll call reverse helper of 54,321 and 0, which is a base case. Actually, is the other way around. It will call with 0 and comma is the quotient after division. Actually, it will immediately return the value because the digit... Oh, no, it will not. It will do one more step to return the final value. That's how we reversed an integer. And similarly, you can basically do other operations. Okay, great. So I believe that we finished the lab. So what I propose that you do during the class today, you should watch the videos that I posted for the recursion from Piazza. Basically, there are videos that already talk about recursion, and we actually have very good videos from last year, and you should watch them, recursion 1 and recursion 2. Meanwhile, I'm starting the recording so I can post the YouTube video for the lab on YouTube immediately around 1 o'clock. It will take 1 hour to record it. We just finished the lab, so and then you can do the lab. If you have other problems or recursion, you can just propose them in the chat and you can solve them too. There are a lot of problems on recursion that we basically can implement with Java, with C, with other languages. In this class, we are going to do Java. I recommend sites like CodingBat, Recursion 1 and Recursion 2. They are very good exercises for recursion. The link, I will post it in the chat. And if you have any questions, we can solve them. Thank you very much, and I will record the lecture for your colleagues.